Can we develop tourism in Sri Lanka without destroying the very nature, people and culture that we are trying to promote?
There's a saying, you know, that road to hell is paved with good intentions, right?
Our guest today has been able to successfully do just that in the quaint village of Belihul Oya in Sri Lanka.
There's this sense of working together with the locals, and there's a lot, I think, that can be taken away for other stakeholders from your approach.
We also speak about the challenges he's faced and the overall benefit of creating a sustainable model of tourism for all stakeholders involved.
I had no experience in the industry other than staying in hotels.
If you are someone that's interested in getting involved in the booming tourism sector of Sri Lanka, we highly recommend watching this episode until the end.
Hi everyone and welcome back to our channel. This is Sri Lanka. Today we've got another exciting talk with a gentleman known as Bandula Abeysinghe. Mr. Bandula, thank you for joining us. He is the founder of Glenrock Hotel, a hotel that we're at right now and making a video on at this very moment. And we are so blown away by the concept, the idea, the ethics and the morals that you have adhered to when building this place that we decided we must have a talk with you.
Thank you.
Yes. So, Bandula, if you don't mind, could you maybe tell us firstly what made you want to start the place, how you came about it? It's a beautiful property, one of the nicest properties we've actually seen around the country. Could you tell us a bit about how you found it and what made you want to start this?
Actually, this is sort of by accident. Mm-hmm. I was looking for a place for myself to maybe build a couple of rooms.
Yeah.
For me to stay with my friends and family sometimes, you know, when we have time. I never had any idea of building a hotel. But, you know, eventually we initially built two rooms for us.
Okay.
Then, you know, with the time and with friends visiting and, you know, with the idea, they were giving us a nice place. And actually, initially, I was going around the country when I had time. I'm traveling a lot, especially in Sri Lanka. And then I wanted to find a place right next to a beautiful river. So once I found that, I just fell in love and started from there. Yeah, that was 2013 November.
Yeah, sure, go for
it. I've been meaning to ask you this since we came and we had our chat yesterday. What is the reason behind the choosing of the name Glenrock? Is there anything particular?
Glen, actually, the Belihul Oya, we are right at the glen. Glen is a small valley. Uh-huh. And rock is actually, this is all rocks everywhere I can see. And also the immediate, this is the main village here is Ihala Galagama, that is Galagama is rock village anyway.
Yes.
Right.
And we are in a smaller village, Ulugala Tan. Mm. Yeah, that is also Ulugala, all rocks here. So rock and the glen, you know, with that.
Perfect.
It
yeah.
came with the name.
That's a
the
great
glen
name.
Rock.
That's
Thank
awesome. You. So one thing very interesting for us in the little chat that we had the other day was that you are someone who has had no background in the hospitality or tourism industry per se.
Not at all.
But you've managed to do this and you've done it so well. It's really a great example, I think, for a lot of people of what like a tourism operation can be. And a mistake we've seen is that a lot of people think it's very easy to start a hotel by themselves. A lot of people start it as a passion project or a side project. And then they soon realize it's a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
But what we found very interesting was when you said you've built it from the ground up, you were involved in the construction, you were involved in the hiring and the management of it and also the selling of the property. What has that experience been like?
Actually, as you just rightly said, I had no experience in the industry other than staying in hotels. So when we, you know, added more rooms to that initial two rooms, then came the idea, okay, for the people, you know, who are coming here, then we have to have a restaurant. Then came the restaurant, but actually I don't know how it happened. So I wanted to build it with iron and the steel and the wood. And so even I cannot sort of believe, you know, how nice it came.
Yeah.
Especially the restaurant, and we have three different room types. One is a total cabana type and the other one modern suites, and the other one is a fusion. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we did not have any sort of, you know, researching or getting any advice or anything. It's all common sense sort of. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I worked with the ground level people. Mm-hmm. Always with the, like, for example, the mason, the carpenter. I directly worked with them and got their ideas directly, and then finally I made the decision. But I got even the labor staff, you know, because they have special, they are all from almost all from this village area. Mm-hmm. So they have this what do you call that, knowledge.
Yeah.
Ground level knowledge, especially about the area and their own knowledge. For example, you know, I still remember, you know, there was a water, you know, the sort of leakage from the stream. Mm-hmm. And then I talked to one of my friends who was an engineer, and he told he asked me to put a concrete under that to you know, the stop that. Mm-hmm. But then I talked to one of the villagers, and he said, you know, no, this special sort of grass, special grass in the sense that grass is grown here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, when you grow it on the bank of the small stream, you know, it stops the
wow.
seepage, you know.
Yeah,
so you,
yeah, that kind of
local
knowledge. Yeah,
yes.
Exactly. Yeah.
And I think going off on that track that you have just spoken about the locals, this is, I think, an example of how you can come into a very remote village and build something like you have, but also not really disturb the natural environment that I'm talking about, the nature, but also the culture and the lifestyle of the people. Your hotel is like hidden here, where when I went for my village walk around the place, I couldn't spot it after a little while. And there's this sense of working together with the locals. And there's a lot, I think, that can be taken away for other stakeholders from your approach, because it's not always about the biggest building and the most rooms with ACs and that kind of thing. Could you tell us about a little bit maybe of the challenges as a person who runs a hotel that you have come across while trying to do this, and some of the solutions you have? Like you said, working with the locals and with their knowledge is very vital, but how you...
Oh yeah, there have been so many challenges, you know. Initially, you know, this is a unique hotel because we live in harmony with the village. So we don't have boundaries. So, and also most of the people who are working here from either from the immediate village or from the surrounding village.
Mm.
So actually, but even if I had that privilege of getting their knowledge, but you know, there were so many misunderstandings about that is fair, you know, by on their part.
As an outsider coming
exactly,
into their village,
you know,
right?
Most of the outsiders who come here, they destroy the village also. No?
Mm.
Yes.
And I am from a village initially. I was born in a village, and I did not want to anyway, for whatever reason, for any financial gain, ruin the village life. You know, I wanted to preserve and not to damage their cultural values or whatever, not to disturb them. And
and that actually adds to the product as well, because you can see that life when a foreigner comes, they get to see it intact instead of
something
strange,
just to
twisted
foreigner.
Version of it. Yes, like somewhere, you know, you're not having people come and do dances and showcase certain things.
Yeah, we don't let day out people or the big gatherings, party lovers, and because you know, the main reason is not because we are opposed to partying or anything, but you know, in this village, if we get them, you know, it disturbs this culture, you know, and even the noise, even you know, the way, you know, when party people behave. I mean, there's nothing wrong in having doing a party. So, because of that, actually, we had to sort of, you know, the strategy was to have minimum number of rooms and get the maximum number of income out of that. And also I wanted to focus the project to, you know, earn foreign exchange to the country.
Yes.
And using the potential of this small village with 10 rooms and actually sort of I wanted to prove a point that, you know, the value and the potential of the small villages in Sri Lanka.
Not and the people within it.
And the people. They are resilient people. And also we have to actually, now there should be somebody with some knowledge, some, you know, the who can invest to like lead them and get their knowledge, you know, that is what happened here. It was not a planned thing, but it happened. It happened.
Yeah, that's very interesting, and that's something that I also wanted to touch on. So what you said about, and I think we forgot to introduce that he's
a lawyer
by profession, and you also have an immigration law firm, a practice. And so you've also spent a lot of time outside the country. I think you're in between two countries.
That's right.
Yeah. And one thing I noticed somewhere in one of the things that I read was that that this is a project to, like you said, show people that you can generate dollars out of this, but also from a personal standpoint to also contribute back to the country.
Exactly.
And I think, especially with our audience, we've seen and met so many people who have a similar idea and who want to sort of find a way to contribute back. Not obviously, maybe not everyone can build a hotel straight away, but there are different ways. And how, and as someone, you know, in the business of immigration and seeing a lot of these people leave the country, how do you think that fits into sort of a value proposition that we can look at for Sri Lankans going abroad, for them to kind of see whether it is something that they could feasible, like, you know, living in another country,
but having an
investment and then maybe even operating an investment here. Of course, your situation is slightly different. You have a team here.
Mm-hmm.
But is that sort of thing possible for someone, an individual living abroad?
It is challenging. Actually, yeah. I think, you know, the government should do something, because, you know, there are so many people, I think great majority of Sri Lankan migrants who are living abroad, you know, since I have the immigration law firm also, I have so many clients as well, and they love this country, they want to come back, but still, you know, for whatever reasons, you know, that is a bigger topic. So they are sort of forced to live beyond these shores. They actually, even if they want to come, I know now when you look at this project, you know, it is, now you can see it's beautiful, but not many people can, you know, the withstand the challenges, you know.
Yes.
Challenges, you know, the initial you have to face, especially, you know, when you are in a village, sort of. Actually, you know, but anyway, my concept was, what I wanted to do was, like, you know, to showcase that, you know, that we can, you know, the investments, businesses can be integrated into a village, and then the villagers benefit, also get benefited,
yes.
And also the country gets benefited if you focus it correctly.
Yes.
Like, you know, now I could have built a hotel here, like, you know, the focusing only the locals. Yes, it's a nice river, it's iconic Belihul Oya here.
Yes.
Right?
Great place to have a drink.
Exactly, you know. So the best place to have a drink and, you know, have a blast here.
Yeah.
But I wanted it not to happen
like that.
Yes.
I wanted it a different way to attract especially foreign tourists who are in love with nature.
Mm.
Yes.
So otherwise, you know, if this place had gone to a wrong hands,
yeah,
actually this place could have been destroyed.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you can see, actually I came from Malla 2-3 days back, I was staying there. You can see the, you know, it is
over-tourism, you know, has taken place.
Not, yeah, over-tourism, as well as it's not the right tourists we need, you know, in Sri Lanka. And the things happening, you know, in Miris, like, you know, the all all the bad things that comes with the tourism. Mm-hmm. But here, no bad things actually. Mm-hmm. So we are very careful about that.
Yeah. Yes.
It's a challenge.
Yes, definitely. Yeah.
But you know, we have been successful so far. Mm-hmm. But it is you know, in terms of income also, we get less income because of those limitations we have put on ourselves.
Mm. Yeah. Right. But I think it's good that you have a very clear idea of who your audience is. And even though it may be that you have limitations now, with the right marketing eventually, you know, that's another component that will eventually add on to the business, you will be able to stand out. You'll have carved yourself a literal niche in the mountains. And that's actually what I think after I've seen the place. But I want to just expand a little bit on what you mentioned. You said it was actually quite challenging to do this. You know, it's we are seeing the end product. Everyone will look at the end product of anything and say,
yeah,
amazing work.
And think, oh, I can do it
I can do it too. And specifically talking about the attitude that you need when you're working with Sri Lankans. Because I now, as Sri Lankans who are living here, we are used to the there's a certain way you have to approach people. There's a certain level of respect. There's a certain kind of way to work with them that you have to know. This is something that I think we have to openly discuss.
But when you come from
abroad, when you're a foreigner, it's very difficult because foreigners are used to like, if you're a foreigner doing business here, things are done in a certain way. So you can't like get mad at the local villager or the local boss and say you're supposed to be here at 9 o'clock. He'll say I'm not coming at all. So it's you have to find different ways to motivate them. But I think it's an issue that a lot of migrants, Sri Lankans who left the country, also face when they come back here, because there's this expectation of why isn't it like the way it is from the place I came from. But I you have been very successful in handling that. How have you been able to keep, because it's very easy to lose touch of that when you leave Sri Lanka for a very long time. You expect things to run in an orderly fashion and, you know, things to happen a certain way. You have to be at peace a little bit here, knowing that sometimes things will not go your way and you have to be okay with it. Sri Lanka is a place, if you're trying to do a business here, it will teach you something. Can you tell us a little bit about that aspect? It's a very important thing for foreigners and like people who have left Sri Lanka, migrants who want to come back. This is something important they should know so that they don't fail immediately or get disheartened immediately.
Yeah, they actually, whoever wants to come and, you know, do a business in Sri Lanka, they have to be prepared for the challenges. But challenges can be overcome. We have proven that. You have to be patient. Got to be patient, and initially, especially, you know, if you are working with these village people, actually we have to understand, you know, what they think, you know. They always have bad experiences from people coming from town, cities, foreign people, and they are coming and they are, you know, taking, they want to make money, exploiting, exactly. So we have to give some time, right? And you should not give up. Unless, you know, you don't want to like persevere, you know, with a plan, you know, until it succeeds, you should not start there.
Yeah. Is it you have to build a relationship with the people?
Of course. I think I have that naturally, because I always work with even the garden staff, you know, even I myself work with them sometimes, you know, I have that natural love for them. So I am not like, even if I am the owner, you know, I don't keep a distance with them. I always, you know, I work with the ground level. So that probably is one of the secrets. For that, for this project to, you know, come this far. We have a long way to go though.
I want to talk a little bit about the tagline of the hotel, which is nature meets luxury. And this is, you know, taglines get thrown around very often. But your one, I feel, we feel.
As we went into the room, as I had the AC and I had Wi-Fi and I was looking into a jungle with the river at the bottom, I couldn't think of three better words to sort of describe that. Like, that is nature meets luxury.
Yeah. And it's not something that is very easy to come by, because when you're in a place that's very remote and close to nature, very rarely do you have the other side, which is the internet and all of the, those luxuries easily, very easily accessible, yes. So you've actually created a very special place for this type of traveler called a digital nomad, is what we were discussing. But you also mentioned something along the lines of how when you rest your mind, especially in nature, you come back even better, more ideas. So do you think that this is actually a really great place for people who are looking for that?
Exactly. You know, I myself do that. You know, when I get time, you know, I go to a quiet place. Not, I mean, even before I, you know, the build this hotel, just by myself, somewhere quiet, and you know, sometimes with my work, and you know, then I rest. And you know, when you rest your mind, like, you know, I have seen people using this word like, what is that?
Brainstorming.
Yes. And I think brain calming is better than brainstorming, because once you calm your brain, it generates ideas
better.
Definitely.
Yeah, it is called actually, I mean, I have heard that word, I mean, Viveka Buddhi. You need Viveka Buddhi. It's like even in Gautama Buddha's words also, like, you know, I think Samma Sati, Samma Samadhi, that kind of, you know, you need that peace of mind, mindfulness.
Yes.
They all come, you know, when you are in a place like this, and all by yourself and relaxing, and you know, with the nature, things you know that you cannot believe, you know, come into your mind. You know, you change your plans, you adjust your plans. You know, then you know you can sit and you know think about whether I have done the right thing. You know, with the brain calmed, you get right decisions most of the time.
Definitely. And on that, one thing I think in our conversation, of course, everyone in the tourism industry in Sri Lanka has faced very tough times in the last 4 years. But you've stuck to that. Like you said, you know, you didn't, just because COVID came, you didn't have to change, you didn't open it up to have parties and do other things to sort of sustain. And that's very difficult, and it's not something everyone might have the privilege to do. But you know, saying that, the way you built around it, what was your thinking there to not pivot and to keep that? And what do you think, how do you think that's going to benefit you going forward? We can see it, but we'd like to think of, you know, as someone who's went through each of those times, what was your thinking when you decided? So you actually had to you close the whole place down during COVID. So making those tough decisions as a hotel owner, and this is your only hotel, so you don't have other hotels sort of helping this keep float and the staff. How do you manage that sort of situation?
Before that, I will answer that question actually. There's a saying, you know, that road to hell is paved with good intentions, right? So, you know, we have closed this for a long time, I think more than 2 years, until, you know, the things get better. You know, I did not want to like open this for and, you know, ruin this village. But, you know, with that you have challenges. You know, we have some bank loans, right? I had to, you know, use funds from my other income sources. I have suffered a lot, you know, sticking to the my ideals, sort of. You know, I did not compromise, even if there were financial challenges, I did not compromise values and whatever the initial plan we had. But again, you know, that could be the road to hell. But you know, things now getting better, right? Hopefully, you know, the tourism will you grow.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah, we can see now it is happening. So I have some experience in earlier business as well. You know, the, you know, I have gone down a lot, but I, you know, the, I did not give up. And then all of a sudden, you know, the tide was turned, and then I was they are to, you know, the you know, the get the gain, you know, yeah, out of that. By that time, you know, that so many people had left.
Yes.
So I hopefully, you know, it, the same thing will work here. Otherwise, you know, the it's a financial, it's a huge challenge.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I have suffered a lot financially.
Mm.
But you know, the hopefully, I can see some light at the end of the tunnel now. You know.
Definitely. Yeah. If you can give some advice to people who are young entrepreneurs, stakeholders in the tourism industry, maybe, you know, in even in rural areas, I suppose, who may believe that to have a successful tourism business, the key is to build a tall building, lots of rooms, lots of put some AC, some tile, throw in a couple of pools also. Which are actually not very sustainable. They're actually quite bad for the environment, is what I've learned recently. What kind of advice would you give to them? Do you think it's necessary to go in that angle? Because I know you have only a very few rooms here as well. And it's all built in a very different style.
Yeah, my actually sort of concept is, you know, like, now we can, businesses have to sustain, like, you know, we have to make money.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Have to, you know, pay for salaries and expenses, everything, and also for the investment we have to
return,
you know,
yeah,
we have to get a return. So for that, you know, you have 2-3 ways, like, you know, you can have 100 rooms with 10,000 rupees,
mm-hmm,
you get say 1 million. You can have 10 rooms with say 100,000 rupees, mm-hmm, and you and with that you probably target the foreigners, like,
yeah,
like Maldives, you know,
yes,
good high-end foreigners, you know, that's what we need in this country at the moment.
Definitely.
And so with 10 rooms also you get 1 million, mm-hmm, with 100 rooms also you get 1 million. So, but the difference is, if you had built 100 rooms here to sell for 10,000, you would have already ruined this place.
Yes.
Actually, that's basically, I think, what has happened. I mean, not 100%, I mean, that way,
mm,
in Al and very so also, you know, like, you can, you get less income from foreigners.
Mm.
Yes.
But more foreigners bring, yes, money, that is good for, actually.
Small, like the...
Yeah, yeah, small, exactly, yeah, small boutiques.
But it changes the entire village, it changes the entire concept of the culture and everything.
I saw that, you know, recently, and I have seen that in other places as well. But, you know, for your question, you don't have to actually spend so much money also to, you know, the, get that kind of income, you know, higher income, better people.
Yes.
So, if you stick to basics, right, you provide some comfortable place to sleep and a good bathroom,
mm-hmm,
and safety, mm-hmm, and then in the midst of nature,
mm,
and you can actually operate a very successful tourist business, mm, it's a hotel,
mm,
so you don't have to ruin the environment, ruin the village, ruin the people's cultures or values or anything. I mean, without doing that,
yes,
keeping them intact without damaging any of those things, you, mm-hmm, still can make money for the villages, for the country, and for yourself as well. As a businessman, you have to make money.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah, I think that's awesome. I think a great way to end it. And just to add to what you said about, you know, withstanding the tough times and sticking to your vision, as people who are like always in hotels, what we see here, we see tremendous potential. And I think it's only a matter of time till it really booms. And I commend you on sticking to that and doing that, because very rarely have we come across someone who's been able to hold on to that even throughout all the tough times.
Yes.
So,
and also I should thank you both also, because, you know, like, by, you know, taking not only my hotel, right?
Yes.
That beautiful places, you know, the value of the, you know, the nature and all these things to our own Sri Lankans, you know.
Very important.
And lots of Sri Lankans go abroad, you know, they tour. There's nothing wrong with that, right? You make money, you go,
yeah,
wherever,
yes,
you want to go.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you show people, you know, the, how beautiful this country is, you know, then they get to travel within Sri Lanka.
Yeah.
And
yes,
in instead of going out of Sri Lanka, that means you are saving foreign exchange.
Definitely.
Otherwise, if they go out, you know, they spend,
definitely,
dollars, you know.
Yes.
So that way also you are doing a great job, you know.
Thank you so much.
Happy I met you both.
Yes,
you.
Likewise.
We are happy we met you very as well.
We are also very inspired by everything you've done here.
Yeah. Yes.
I'm really happy because you are very young and good to see, you know, you have to, yeah, you know, take this. Because, you know, this country, you know, we have come through lots of problems, you know, during our, when I was in the university, mm-hmm, even in 83, July riots, you know, I was in Colombo. In when I was in the university, this 86, 89 problems, you know, all this, I think during our lives we suffered the worst.
Yes.
But you know, for people like you should, you know, lead, yeah, this country the into the future. So the, what you are doing, actually you are contributing greatly to towards that, you know, that's great.
Thank you so much. We really appreciate that. Yeah. Like yourself, we also want to do something for the country, and you know, it may seem like a big challenge sometimes to correct a big problem, but if one person can start and inspire another person and have that effect take place,
that will be
I think the solution.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I think that was an awesome chat. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Definitely come and first of all check out our vlog on the place. It's phenomenal. We're still on day 2 of filming. And that will be on our main channel.
Yeah.
And if ever you are in Belihul Oya, definitely come check out the Glenrock.
This video will probably come out before our vlog, right?
No, it will come out after.
So make sure you go and check the Glenrock video.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
A special thank you to our patrons for your continued support. If you'd like to empower us to create more impactful stories like this, then consider joining us over at Patreon.